If you would, I want you to meet me in the book of Colossians. Meet me in the book of Colossians, chapter 1. As it is the custom of this house, if you rise on your feet for the reading of the word. Hallelujah to the Lamb. Colossians chapter 1, I just want to read two verses in your ear. Meet me at verse 21 and 22. I'll be reading from the New King James Version. Hallelujah. When you have it, say amen. Those of you online, if you grab your devices or look on screen, follow us and read that text for yourself. The New King James Version, it says here, verse 21. And you, who once were alienated and enemies in your mind by wicked works, yet now he has reconciled in the body of his flesh through death to present you holy and blameless and above reproach in his sight. My. You can read that again. He says, and you, he's talking to the children of God. And you, who once were alienated and enemies in your mind by wicked works, yet now he has reconciled in the body of his flesh through death to present you holy and blameless and above reproach in his sight. My Lord, to present us, giant prayer with me, you and I, holy, I said you and I, holy and blameless, knowing we've done some things, he said blameless and above reproach. Who can lay an accusation to your charge? My. If you would, please take your seat. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. You know, I'm amazed that when you look at the Word of God, how sometimes the Lord will give you illumination so that you can see something that you can relate to that is practical, but then yet ready you can apply from a theological perspective. For the word we know is alive and it's living and it speaks to us even this day, though it was written over 2,000 years ago. It's interesting when I think about this text, I think about the immensity of what God would do for us. In those two verses, there's a lot of stuff packed in those two verses. I'm reminded that when I think about these two verses, I was reminded of something that I saw on TV, and maybe you've seen something similar to that on the news. Have you ever seen on the news a police chase? The perpetrator is running, and the police are in hot pursuit. More often than not, we generally see something like that in California, where they're on the highway, they're wide open. And the bad guy or the bad lady, whoever it might be, the driver, are throwing everything they can to get away. They're running because they violated the law. They did something that was criminal. And they're seeking to get away. But law enforcement is in hot pursuit. One of the things that law enforcement has always thought about is how do we stop these kinds of chases so that we minimize collateral damage and death to people and our property damage. How do we stop it? And one of the things I saw when I first time ever seeing something like this was that law enforcement was following the car and they were in hot pursuit and they were on a highway and they were going fast. And it would seem as though the police cruiser was right behind the car, but then he slightly moved to the right, sped up a little bit and tapped the rear of the perpetrator's vehicle. And as a result of that, doing that, it caused the perpetrator's car, the person trying to get away, the person trying to run, caused the vehicle to swerve out of control, and the driver lost control, and it hit the divider on the highway, and the pursuit was over. They was captured. They call that a pit maneuver. My. A pit maneuver. When you're driving after a person, this truly, you're talking about how they manipulate, just blatantly speed up, tap the side of that car. The pit maneuver. All designed to stop the fleeing person, to do it quickly with minimal risk to people and property. Where I declare to you, what's interesting about that is that when I look at these two verses and when I look at what God is doing and has done for you and I, is that he's done everything he can to reconcile us, because at one point in our lives, we were running. Some of us might very well be still running today, and God is in hot pursuit. See, we never run to God, we run away from him. Y'all ain't praying with me. See, this is why when you falter and you fail, the enemy don't want you to come to the household of worship. He wants you to stay home. Okay, amen, lights and walls. See, we're running from him as opposed to running to him. And yet he's in hot pursuit. And what I found through the Apostle Paul, who penned this text, is that we can look at what God is doing and has done for you and I, in that he employed a pit maneuver for you in my life. He did that so that he can stop us from running. He did that because you and I were running from what he called us to do. So he had to employ, see, thank you, Hope. See, the pit maneuver was done because we were not doing what we needed to do. Okay, y'all believe? Okay. Y'all remember Jonah? Yeah, amen, lights and walls. Jonah was used by God, called by God, but Jonah didn't feel like doing what God said do. So he got on a boat, Carnival Cruise of that day, said, I'm going in the wrong direction. I know how to get away from God. And he said, I'm going to go this way. And yet God, in all of his providence and sovereignty, employed a pit maneuver. The pit maneuver was a great fish. They threw him overboard, swallowed him up, kept him for 3 days. Amen. Like, kept him for 3 days, ultimately to find that I got something in my belly. I need to spew this out on the beach. And there was ultimately Jonah laying on the beach, prostrating and ready to surrender. I said, some of us are running. And God's got to employ a pit maneuver so that we can do what he called us to do. Amen. When you think of it, David wrote in Psalm 139, 7, he said, where shall I go from your spirit? Or where shall I flee from your presence? My. See, when you think about David, he was on a run too. But God had to employ a pit maneuver to get him to the place where he needed to be. If I think about the children of Israel, they were always depicted in the Bible of running, going different places. And yet when you look at it, it says that they often are people careening down a path of destruction. And yet God, in all of who he is, employs a pit maneuver. Okay, amen. Let me make it practical. All of us represent sheep in the Bible. Sheep have a tendency to wander. Yeah, they do. If they give an opportunity, they will wander and go places that they ain't supposed to go. Then have the unmitigating gall to get dirty and then complain about being dirty. And they were the one that caused the dirt. And yet God got to employ a pit maneuver. He got to come to get us right back where we need to be. See, when I look at this, all of us have a natural proclivity to run from God. In either word, thought, deed, attitude, or motive, every one of us has ran from God instead of to him. And yet God says, I'm going to do whatever I need to do in order to get you back to where you need to be. I'm going to reconcile you back to me. And I'm going to employ whatever methods I need to meet you at your point of need. In these two verses, we see what God is doing as the Apostle Paul wrote. There are three things I want to share with you. I want to talk about the need for reconciliation. I want to talk about the way of reconciliation. And then I want to talk about the purpose of reconciliation in the name of Jesus. Y'all pray for me, please. When I think about this text says here, the first point is the need for reconciliation. When you look at the text in verse 21, he says, and you who were alienated and enemies in your mind by wicked works. Stop right there. See, that's enough to let you and I know that we needed some reconciliation. See, when you look at this, when I think about this, the people that Paul was writing to, as I said, are the saints of God. He's not talking to the sinners. He's talking to the brethren, the brothers, because here's the thing. They hadn't always been where we are today. Oh, my, walk with me. I'm going someplace here. You think about what he said. We have been alienated. What, if you think about this alienation, that word alienate means we are estranged. That means we are separated. We're not together. We're not in unity. If you look at Ephesians chapter 2, verse 12, it says something about that alienation. It says here, when it comes up, it says that at a time you were without Christ, being aliens from the commonwealth of Israel and strangers from the covenants of promise, having no hope and without God in the world. God says, prior to me, you had no hope. Prior to me, you were nothing. Prior to me, you were nobody. Prior to me, you had no capability in yourself. Prior to me, you couldn't redeem yourself from nothing. But God, who's rich in mercy, full of compassion, foreknew you and I, still said, I choose you. See, you got to make that personal. He said, I choose you. See, if you're estranged, if you're alienated, you're cut off. You're cut off from salvation. You're cut off from some hope. See, we were enemies of God, openly hostile towards the things of him in our mind and in our behavior. See, it's interesting. You got to ask yourself, well, Paul, why are you reminding us of what we used to be? Paul said, because I'm on a mission to tell you to bring it back to your remembrance. This is the reason why you need reconciliation. Stop thinking of yourself more highly than you ought to. The Apostle Paul says that some of us think we walk on water. And he said, some of us need to recognize that we don't walk on water. And if it had not been the grace of God, where would we be? See, that's the thing. He said, you need reconciliation so you can appreciate the grace that I've given you. See, look, he said, listen, when you talk about what he says, why does Paul bring this up? Because he said, you need to be able to appreciate the grace that God has showered on you. That's why I got to remind you from whence you have been brought. See, he said, you used to be alien to him. That was before the cross. It's after the cross. We're still doing stuff. Okay, can I talk to folks over here? He said, after the cross, you still ain't doing it right. I delivered you. I healed you. I anointed you. You can sing with praise, and you're still not doing it right. Can I talk to you here? He said, you're still not where you need to be. Didn't I not save your soul? Didn't I not provide for you? Why are you not following who I am? God says, you forgot the grace that I showered on you. He said, yeah, I know you study. I know you can read a couple of scriptures. I know you memorize a couple of verses. You can sing some, Lord, take my hand. Lead me on. Come on now. And God says, why are you still not following me? Grace he has showered on you. See, you, when I think about where we are, you got to make that thing personal. What's hindering you from serving him? What are you putting in front of him? And yet he has never stopped putting things in front of you. He's always made a way for you, even when it didn't feel like it. That was grace that was showered on you. When you think about what he's doing, how he's doing it in our life, he said, I've given you some grace. Lord have mercy. Grace, that grace lets us know that we have been fully justified. My. See, we said, you need to know that there's some reconciliation because you've been doing things in times past and some of that residue is still on you. My. See, you got a new nature, but you still got the old one. Okay, on a good day, let somebody get on your last nerve. Catch you on a bad day, when your money low, when your kids going crazy. You might use some colorful language. Yeah, I ain't praying. Okay, amen, lights and walls. I said, I'm just looking for some honest people. God already knows where you are. You don't have to front in front of me. If you look at this grace, he says, grace is by grace we are saved. Lord have mercy. That grace that he extended to us, that grace that he's given us, grace is unlimited in its resources. Listen, it's where sin abound, grace that much more abound. That means that, you better pray. You better. That's shouting right there. Lord, in spite of me, in spite of what I've done, in spite of where I've been, grace far exceeds that. So now I know why he can say, when you confess your sins, he said he's just and faithful to forgive you, then to cleanse you from all unrighteousness. Grace enables that. Okay, see, when you look at this, grace exists in superabundance and more grace added to that. By my mind. When I see, the need for reconciliation is because you and I have not arrived. We haven't arrived. Because whenever God says do X, we sometimes do Y. Whenever God says do this, we ask why. Have you ever talked to a little child and you tell them to do something? What do they tell you? I said, look, go over there and sit down. What do they say? Because I need you to go over and sit in that chair. Because it's got more comfortable over there. Because I told you to go over there. Because I said so. Y'all ain't praying. Y'all know that's how we do it. And yet we do that with God. God says, read your Bible. Why? Well, you need to pray some more. Why? Don't I pray enough? We do a Jesus wept prayer. I think we did it. Okay, amen. He said this grace, the beauty of grace, is that it's totally unmerited and unconditional. Lord have mercy. See, if the truth be told, we don't deserve the free gift of salvation. We don't deserve the constant help of the Holy Spirit. We don't deserve all the joy and pleasures of this life. But yet God, in all his unthinkable love, he still showers us with grace. Okay, has God ever had to pull you out of something? Just make it personal. Don't look to your left or the right. It's about you. Has he ever had to pull you out of something that you went freely into? And yet God, in all of who he is, reached way back down and said, come here, my child. That ain't where you need to go. Has he ever had to dig? Look, God says sin comes up in his nostrils as stench. Yes, it does. It comes up in his nostrils as stench. Have you ever had to unclog a bathroom toilet after someone used it? It's an unpleasant thing to talk about, but it's a reality that some of us had to do. Every day, you and I may do something against God and all of his righteousness in word, deed, attitude, and motive. And God says, it's coming up to me like I got to go clean the bathroom again. When I think about his immense grace that he showered on you and I, we ought to thank God each and every day. There should be a constant praise on our lips because of the grace that he showered on you and I. God said, you didn't get to where you are because of you. I got you to where you are. And yet we walk around thinking we did it. I said, who's in control? Stop trying to be the pilot and let God be the pilot. You be the co-pilot. Matter of fact, if the truth be told, I'm going to be a passenger in first class. I don't even need to be in the cockpit. God got that thing. When you think about what he's doing, he said, literally, the reason we need this reconciliation is because every day we got to recognize we are estranged even from the womb. God said it started all the way back then. If you look at Psalm 58, chapter 58, verse 3, it speaks to the fact that we are estranged from the womb. David said, listen, you got to not forget that the children are born, they are lovely, they are gracious, they're kind, but them children, when they are little babies, as beautiful as they are, have an Adamic nature. That means you don't have to teach them how to lie. Okay, y'all ain't praying with me. I know when we go to the hospital, we see the little babies, how they so precious and so cute, looking so adorable. This little thing can go and grow up to do some diabolical things. That's why you get them at terrible twos. They need to come up with ones. because they start there. When you think about what we do, the Lord tells us, never forget from whence you've come. You don't have to live there. You just don't forget so you can appreciate the grace that God has given you. See, listen here. See, the thing here is that sometimes when you're surrounded by dirt, you're better witness for what's beautiful. And see, when you think about where you are, you should never forget you live amongst dirt. And sometimes if you're not careful, you'll get dirty. So you need to be focused on how can I be a better witness of the beauty of who God is. And so when I think about this need for reconciliation, Lord, thank you for your grace. Thank you that you give me this grace. And the key is all that can hinder you and I from him, God says, I have removed through the work of grace. Nothing can hinder us from serving him. Why? Because we're no longer under the penalty of sin and we're no longer under the power of sin. That means when something occurs, we have made a choice. Okay, amen. Lights are off. That's why grace is amazing. Sin is serious. Grace is amazing. And it far exceeds what you and I could ever do. That's why they sing that song, Amazing Grace. How sweet the sound that saved the wretch, listen to me, like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. See, when you're able to say amazing grace, I'm the beneficiary of amazing grace. I've been touched by the eternal one. I've been given some amazing grace. I've been brought out of some things I should have been killed back into. But God looked back and said, bring my son forward because I'm going to navigate the circumstances of the situation. When it looked like he's not going to win, he's going to win. Because greater is he that's in me than he that's in the world. And no matter what, the good steps of a man are ordered by the Lord. Though you may stumble, though you may falter, you shall not fall ultimately down because the righteousness of his hand will uphold you. God says you will never get too bad for him to be able to reach you. And there's nothing that you can do that will be out of his reach. God says, I got your back, I love you, and you ought to just flow in that. We need some reconciliation because it's the cross that was used for you and I as a pit maneuver. See, if it had not been for the cross, you and I would be in here just having a party. Y'all ain't praying with me. We'd move chairs out the way and do something different. If it had not been for the cross, thank God for the cross because guess what? We ran from the law. We ran from the prophets. We ran from this grace. And God said, I got to use a pit maneuver to reconcile you back to me. And that's what I used was the cross. So when I think about the need for reconciliation, I got to recognize there is a need. And every now and then we still need it because of what we do. But we not only need to know that there's a need for reconciliation, we need to know the second point is that there's a way of reconciliation. There is a way. See, it says here, in the body of his flesh through death. Listen to that. He says in verse 21, go there. He says, yet now he has reconciled. Yet now he has reconciled. Look, he said in verse 21, he said, you once were, past tense. But then he comes down in that same sentence and says, yet now he has reconciled. Listen, he has reconciled. Not your pastor, not your mother, not your father, not your husband, not your wife, not your children. He has reconciled. God has reconciled. Jesus has reconciled me to himself. He said, I once was alien to him, but now I am fellowship with him. I once, past tense, but now. Good gracious from Zion. See, when you look at it that way, he said, listen, Christ is the one who effects the reconciliation by his death. See, it's really all about the cross. See, the cross is where we need to focus on. The cross is where we need to rest in. We shout because of what was done at Calvary's cross. Because it had not gone to the cross for you and I, where would we be? When I think about this thing, he said we are reconciled by his death. We are reconciled by his shed blood. We're reconciled by that cross at Calvary. See, when Paul talked about that, he said reconciled. He was speaking to the fact that people were coming up in that day with some heresy. They come up with some heresy. Whenever you think about someone trying to attack Christianity, the first thing they want to attack is Jesus Christ. Have you ever noticed that you could talk about anything, anything on your job? I said anything. Did not know the conversation that occurred in the breakout kitchen? Anything. But the moment you say something about Jesus Christ, you want to cause some ruckus? You want to call somebody to get down to HR and say you need to go see the folks in HR because you're trying to proselytize the staff? Talk about Jesus Christ. They want to get at Jesus Christ. And see, there was some heretical teaching that was going on in the day of Paul in the Colossae church. They were going on. There was this group called the Docetism. They pretty much were a group that felt that, you know what? Christ in the human form really wasn't human. He was pretty much a phantom. He was not real. He was a figment of our imagination. They were trying to espouse that mess back then and trying to deny who Christ was. And when you think about him saying, if Christ was not real, then his death wasn't real. If his death wasn't real, his resurrection surely wasn't real. So if I can kill that, then I can kill what they believe. Everything hinges on the Savior. They're going after his humanity. But you see here, when you think about it, Jesus was fully human and his death on the cross was surely real. My. And so when I think about what he says here is that when they try to go at us, to attack us, you got to know that the only way that we could have reconciliation is through the eternal one, and that was Jesus Christ. There's no other name under heaven whereby men must be saved. There's no other name that every knee's going to bow and every tongue's going to confess that he's Jesus and he is the Lord and he's the King of Kings. There's no other name. There's no other name you can call on with power and authority than that which is Jesus Christ. See, his name is above every name. Every name you can think of, his name is above. No matter what it is, his name is above. When you think about what they were trying to do, they were trying to get at the Savior. They were trying to destroy what he represents. But what I'm grateful for is that salvation was accomplished through the one who did nothing less but was truly all humanity and all deity. We had a sin debt because of Adam. And the only way that we could be redeemed with that sin debt, which you and I couldn't pay for, is that we needed an eternal one. And the only one that could be eternal was Jesus Christ. So if you think about, had he not done what he did, if he not tugged on your coattail to draw you to him, you'd still be doing what you used to do. You wouldn't even be here today. Well, let me back up for a minute, Holy Ghost. Some of us did go to church, but we still left and did our own thing. When I think about what he says, the way of reconciliation, he says, listen, when you think about this, he was the God-man. He was the one used to restore mankind. He was the one to restore what Adam lost and to get us back to him. It's all about reconciliation via the cross. See, he had to use that pit maneuver. He had to use this thing to get us from running from him. See, Paul empathized that the physical body of Jesus Christ was nailed to the cross. It was nailed to the cross in the name of Jesus. And people are going to constantly try to deny it. Every time someone says, well, Jesus Christ wasn't, right away I know they want to attack his divinity. They want to attack his deity. Because if they can attack his deity and survive on that, then what do we have to stand on? That's why you and I ought to study to show ourselves approved, rightly dividing the word asunder. So someone coming with a half-truth won't deceive you because they're telling you a whole lie. If you look at this, he said literally in this text here, 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 24. I want to look at this text. He said, who himself bore our sins in his own body on the tree, that we, having died to sins, might live for righteousness, by whose stripes you were healed. My. See, when you look at this, our Christ, my. See, he was the substitute for you and I. Yes, he was. He was the sinless sacrifice for you and I. He is the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by him. If you call on any other name, you're going to have some problems. But if you call on the name of Jesus, surely you're going to get some change. Because when you call on the name of Jesus, things will begin to change. Giant prayer with me. Listen, in the midnight hour, have you ever had to call on the name of Jesus? Have you ever had to call on the one that's high and lifted up? When no one else was around, had you ever had to call on him? See, when you look at what he said, listen, it's on Christ, the solid rock, I stand. That you look at, I'm not trying to stand on no one else's name. I'm not trying to trust in anyone else's name. Why? Because all other ground is sinking sand. I said, on Christ, the solid rock, I stand. That means there's sure enough some stability to that foundation. It's stable. It's not wavering. I can rest on it. I can be comfortable in it because it's Christ, the solid rock, I stand. He said, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground, your bank account, sinking sand. Your job, sinking sand. Your academics, sinking sand. Your car, sinking sand. Your house, sinking sand. God said, on Christ, the solid rock, I stand. No other ground I stand on, because I know it's nothing but sinking sand. What have you been trusting in, saint? What have you been leaning in, saint? Stop thinking about you can stand on your house simply because it's 4,200 square feet. What is that compared to the one who owns the earth and the fullness thereof? My. You ain't praying with me. God says you need to stand on a name that's solid. That name is Jesus, who is the Christ. See, listen, he said he is the way of reconciliation. How do we know that? See, there was a gentleman in the 11th century, a gentleman by the name of Anselm of Canterbury, who wrote a book entitled, Why God Became Man. My. Why God Became Man. See, it was written because of the fact that truly people were trying to knock down who he is. And they tried to say, do we really need a Christ? Do we really need a Savior? And so you had all of these heretics coming up with stuff. But Anselm of Canterbury said that God became man to make an atonement for the sin through his substitutionary death in our place at Calvary's cross. See, when you go back, see, that's why I would encourage you. Don't just read your Bible. Go back and read what was going on through the first and third century church during the patristic period when the church fathers were being used by God to move and talk about different things. You got to know, how do we evolve from where we were to where we are today? That's how you can defend what you believe. It's called apologetics. See, when I think about Anselm of Canterbury, he wrote this because he recognized that we will all suffer in this world, but Christ's suffering was supreme. Why? Because he suffered for you and my sin debt. My. Could you think about it? Listen, yeah, let me make a person. In our household, there was 9 people in our home, 9 kids. And when something was broken, y'all know what happened. My mom, a single mom, would come in. I said, 9 kids, single parent, would come in. And the first thing she would ask, who broke this? 9 kids. What? Amen. You can say it again. Amen, lights and walls. Not me. I wasn't in there when it was broke. No one know nothing. I said, it's amazing to me. Now I look back and see how brain damaged we were by responding to her in that way. Because mama had a way of getting at the answer. She knew that there were some people in this house that belonged to only her. There was no other children in here but hers. And she knew that somebody broke it. So what she would say is that since no one is trying to tell me who broke that thing, I'm gonna beat all of you. Then I know I got the right one. And just before she got to commencing, somebody would step forward. Kevin did it. Y'all ain't praying with me. See, it's amazing when tensions flow, when people get caught up. They know how to cry out when the judgment is being about to pass out. Everybody shrugging their shoulders. I don't know. And I think about what we go through. We do suffer in this life. because it rains on the just and the unjust. But when I think about the way of reconciliation, it is only through Christ. Christ, the solid rock. As St. Augustine says, Jesus was the Son without sin, but not one without suffering. He was sinless, but he had to suffer. And he suffered for you and I. You ought to get excited right there. Because when you think about what he suffered for your life, you don't have to look to nobody but you. Everything you've ever done and everything you will do, he suffered for. That's why I said, yet while you was in sin, Christ died for you and I. My. When I think about the way of reconciliation, thank God it was Jesus Christ. Thank God it was him that went to the cross. Because there was no other person qualified, capable, that could stand in the gap in the name of Jesus. But it's not only the fact that we needed some reconciliation, but we had to recognize there was a way of reconciliation because we needed to be reconciled back to him. That brings us to our third point. It says our purpose of reconciliation. So you had to have a need. We recognized we were sinful after the cross. After the cross. Okay, let me say that. After the cross. Okay, amen. Someone still got the halos on. When we look at that, is a need for reconciliation. There was a way of reconciliation. I was sinful. Christ was the mediator. He was the one that stood in the gap. And now we got to talk about what was the purpose of reconciliation. Well, when I think about the purpose of reconciliation, look at the text. See, he said, listen, when you look at his death, right? If you go to the B portion of the scripture, verse 22, it says, to present you holy and blameless and above reproach in his sight. My. Lord have mercy. There's a whole lot right there. There's a whole lot right there. I said, he said, I'm going to present you and I, holy. You can stop right there. Some of us were not holy even coming in here. Some of us not holy when we were driving, finding a parking space in the lot. Some of us not holy when we was on 77 when that person cut us off in the name of Jesus. But he said, I'm going to present you holy. But what I'm thinking, he didn't stop right there. He said, and look, that's together, right? That's a conjunction. And combined, blameless, and look at the ands. He said, and above reproach. Lord have mercy. Look at it. He said, the purpose of the reconciliation is so that we can have some personal holiness. Some personal holiness. When I look at what he says here, he has reconciled us to himself so that we may share his life and his holiness. My. See, holy and unblameable and unreprovable. Woo, good races from Zion. See, when you think about that, my. If you think about Paul, he goes on to say that God reconciled sinners to himself through the sacrifice of Jesus to present you and I holy, blameless, and above reproach. My. See, the result of Christ's death is redemptive to present you and I holy in his sight. Stop trying to impress people that don't like you. Why are you trying to act a certain kind of way? Like you're so holy and righteous. The one you need to impress is the eternal one. And you can impress him by reading his word. You can impress him by praying. You can impress him by worshiping him and giving him glory. See, we do a lot of job trying to impress one another, but we don't do enough trying to impress him. And when I think about what he said, I want to present you holy and blameless and above reproach. See, Christ's death is the basis for our justification. Not only that justification, meaning that our sin is just as we didn't do it. Lord have mercy. And, listen, and progressive sanctification. See, I said this before. See, I'm in the perpetual posture of being saved. That means every day the Lord is working on me. Every day he's working on you too. I said every day. Every day he's working on us. Because every day we wake up with something that we're going to go through. Every day we work on something that we're going to get upset about. Every day we're going to commit something that's not in light of his word. We're going to do something that sins against him. And God says, I got to sanctify you on a progressive basis, on a daily basis, because we have not arrived. Okay, if the Apostle Paul, who wrote over the third of the New Testament, who was given his commission by Jesus Christ directly, who was caught up to the third heaven, was beaten and stoned and shipwrecked at sea, all of those things, if he said, I have not arrived, what right do you and I have to think that we have arrived? And he was caught up to the third heaven. There's no way that you could have allowed Pastor Kevin to write over the third of the New Testament and think that I would not be able to fit through the door with the size of my head. It would not work. I would have had a different attitude. But yet Paul was humble enough to say, John Mark is good for the gospel, for the ministry, and bring me my parchments. Even before he was going to offer it up for his martyrdom with Nero, before he was going to be killed, he said, I have not arrived, and I still want to read. No one's trying to kill you and I, but we ain't reading. Okay, amen, lights and walls. Again, how much time are we spending in his word? How much time are we reading the scriptures? I'm not talking about any book about the scriptures. I'm talking about the scriptures. How much time are we reading the word of God as it's written in your hand as you've been given? When you think about what he says here, he says, ultimately, when you talk about the progressive sanctification, ultimately, we'll get to the point where we have the ultimate glorification. So when you think about that, we'll ultimately be in his presence. So we're no longer under the power of sin. We're no longer the penalty of sin. And one day soon, we'll no longer be in the presence of sin because we'll be with him. When you think about what he does, the purpose of it is so that you and I can be presented holy and blameless. Lord have mercy. That means without blemish. Blameless means without a blemish. And it implies and applied to the temple sacrifices. See, when you brought a sacrifice to the temple on that day, you didn't bring something that was sickly. You didn't bring something that was blemished. You didn't bring that which was the least of what you had. You brought the best to the temple offering. You and I are living sacrifices. We ought to bring the best to our Savior. That means when I enter his gates with thanksgiving and enter his courts with praise, I ought to enter a good praise. I'll not be walking through the doors murmuring, complaining. Okay, I'm not to be just because I couldn't get my parking space that was normally where I get on the Sunday, so I'm going to be hot about it when I come in. I'm upset because someone sat in the seat that I normally sit in. You know how we own seats where we sit. And when someone comes in and sit where we normally sat, we got an attitude. Okay, ain't no honest folks in the house. Is there any honest folks in the house? All right, maybe it's the other church that you go to. They got the little names on the side of the pew. That's from Mother Such and Such. They pay for that pew. They ain't here yet, but they supposed to sit there. There's nothing wrong with the pew. There's nothing wrong with the parking space. Something wrong with you and I. How is it that we can't be grateful and have praise on our lips, knowing what God has done for you and I? When I think about what he says blameless, without a blemish. That means you're talking about someone that's blameless. God says, I'm going to cause you to be blameless. In my sight, you know, you and I are in good company. Think about Abraham. Listen, Abraham was 99 years old, and the Lord appeared to him and said, I am almighty. Walk before me faithfully and be blameless. My. That's what God Almighty said to Abram. He said, you need to walk before me and be blameless. That means that we're not sinless, but we ought to sin less. We ought to be doing less of what we used to do last year. Okay, amen, lights and walls. When you look at what he says here, the Lord says that one who walks blameless, who does what is righteous, who speaks the truth from their heart. Listen, whose tongue utters no slander, who does no wrong to his neighbor, casts no slur on others. My. God says this in his word. Psalm 15, verses 1 and 3, he says that. That's what we ought not to do. Because truly, when you think about that, he's telling you and I that we need to do some things. And when we do it, God says you're walking right up in his eyesight. We ought to be trying to please him.
Stop trying to press one another. For what reason? When you think about this, he says, do everything without grumbling. Look, in Philippians 2, 14 and 16, he says, do everything without grumbling or arguing so that you may become blameless and pure. My. See, look, God says, I got your back. He said, not only are you going to be made holy in my sight, but you're also going to be made blameless. But he said, there's another thing. He said, I'm going to also present you in my sight so that you literally is going to be above reproach. My. See, above reproach means that you're free from accusations, free from all charges. Satan is the accuser of the brethren and will hurl charges at us, but God will not accept them. Okay, amen. Like, I just got a little cider right there. Satan is going to hurl some stuff at you. He's going to accuse you of some things. He's going to say you did something. He said you, and some of it might be true. But God, I said, but God said, I will not receive it. No matter what he comes with, he said, I don't receive from that which is unholy. God says, who is the accuser of the brethren? Satan, I want to let you know that he's the accuser. Amen, like someone. Praise the Lord with that hand. And you think about what he's doing. He said, I got your back. No one can lay a charge to you. That's why he said in Romans, there is now no condemnation to them who are in Christ Jesus. Lord have mercy. There's no condemnation to you and I. Who can lay a charge to God's elect? God is the one that does what he does. God is the one that delivered. God is the one that anointed. God is the one that healed. God is the one that made us righteous. God is the one that made us whole. God's the one that makes us blameless. God is the one that gives us high and lifted up. God is the one that meets us right where we are. And that's why we ought to celebrate who he is. That's why we ought to get excited about who he is. Because of God. I read that thing. He said, Satan will come with some stuff. People will come with some stuff. But God will not accept it because Christ is my advocate. My. See, he's my advocate. See, some of us need an advocate in a courtroom. In the courtroom of heaven, Jesus Christ is my advocate. He's my public defender. He's my attorney. And when Satan comes, he's got a case. His file is about that big when he lays it down on the table in eternity. And guess what? He tries to accuse you of everything that you ever done and everything that you just did. And God says, the judge said, well, what is the evidence? And Christ, our advocate, says, wait a minute. I got something to say. I want to cross-examine this situation. And he said, listen, in spite of that, I find this evidence, whereas this person is not guilty. And the Father in heaven says, how do you know? He said, because you need to look at my hands. You need to look at my feet. You need to look at my side. You need to see the blood stain on the ground. You need to see the splinters on my back. You need to see the flesh ripped from my back. You need to see the crown that's on my head. I am the one that took that. I'm the one that was blamed. And you cannot have double jeopardy. You can't be convicted for the same crime twice. If Christ took it, Satan can't give it to me. So why are you walking around with your head bowed down? Why are you walking around defeated? It's God that's given us the victory. It's God that's made a way. It's God that's gave you the victory over the sin. Walk in your victory in the name of Jesus. Woo! Lord have mercy. See, he said there's no way that someone can charge you of anything. There's no way people can come with those accusations. They can come try to lay things at your feet, but they cannot change your relationship with God. No matter what it is, saints, they can't change your relationship. Woo! See, listen, when I think about what he does, when I think about there's a need for reconciliation, when I recognize there's a way of reconciliation and there's a purpose, that purpose is for me to be holy, for me to be blameless, and for me to be above reproach. Woo! That's something to get excited about. Because when I think about it, I'm looking to the cross. I'm looking to what Jesus did for me. I'm looking for how he made a way at Calvary's cross. Had he not gone to the cross, where would we be? Had he not laid down his life, where would we be? Had he not allowed his blood to spill, where would we be? Because he was a sacrifice. He was a substitute for you and I, for the atonement to pay the sin debt of humanity, past, present, and future. So when I look at this, the cross is the tool that God used as a pit maneuver because we had no business running from him when we should have ran to him. And God says, I got to track you down do a pit maneuver so that you can put up hands and say, I surrender. My. See, I thank God for the cross. I thank God for Jesus Christ. I thank God for the sacrifice. I thank God for his word. I thank God for the holiness. I thank God for being the shepherd. I thank God for being Jehovah Jireh. I thank God for making a way for me. I thank God for providing food for me. I thank God for putting clothes on my back. I thank God for the roof over my head. I thank God for the work of the cross. I thank God for what he took for me. Thank God for how he beat me. Thank God for how he took it for me. Because had not God taken it, I couldn't say, by his stripes, I am healed. It's only because of what he did at the cross. That's why they say, at the cross, where I saw the light. My. Before the cross, I was walking in darkness. Before the cross, I was doing things I ain't had no business doing. But God, when I came to the cross, and I first saw the light, and the burden of my heart rolled away. In the name of Jesus, go back to the first day he saved your soul. That burden was lifted off of you. That burden was removed from you. He cleaned you up. He put a new right robe on you and said, you are now part of my family. I'm your father. I'm the one that's going to heal you. I'm the one that's going to take care of you. That's why you can say nobody can do you like Jesus. Nobody can do you like the Savior. In the name of Jesus, he said, it was there by faith I receive my sight. Hallelujah to the Lamb. See, I was blind, but now I see. And because of faith, I can see clearly now. I can see through the haze. I can see through the fog. I'm no longer a sinner, no longer bound by sin. All the chains have dropped away because of God. But God stepped in for me. Hallelujah to the Lamb. And it says, and now I am happy all the day. See, I pray with me. See, I get happy about things that are going on. And I move from happy. See, happy is when I'm little in Christ. I'm a babe in Christ. I only know happy. But when I become mature in him, I get joy. Woo! See, when I got joy, it don't matter what's going on in my life. When I got joy, it doesn't matter how it's coming at me. It doesn't matter what they say about me. I ain't got to impress you. I got to impress my Lord and Savior in heaven. See, when I get some joy, I can come in this house and dance before the Lord. I can dance like David danced. I can get happy. I can whip up holy hands. I can worship the true and living God. I can recognize that it's he and he alone that got my back. Hallelujah. When I fall and fail, he's the one that propped me up. When I fall on my knees, he's the one that lifts me up. He's the one that lifts me up. Hallelujah to the Lamb. It's Christ, the solid rock. I said, I stand. All other ground is but sinking sand. Don't you trust in nothing else but trust in Jesus' name. Hallelujah to the Lamb. That's why I can come in here and lift up holy hands, lift up my head in spite of what's going on. Don't matter what's going on. Happiness is contingent about what you're going through, what's happening. But I got joy on the inside. I got joy, unspeakable joy. Do you got some joy in your heart? If you got some joy in your heart, you ought to give God a 30-second praise right now. You ought to praise him. You ought to praise him. You ought to praise him. From the rising of the sun until the going down of the same, you ought to praise him. His name, I said his name is worthy to be praised. I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. I said, I was glad when they said to me, come, let's go to the house of the Lord. Why? Because that's where I first got my sight. In the name of Jesus, you ought to praise your God. What has he done for you? What has he made a way for you of? You ought to praise him for that. If he hasn't done nothing, praise him on credit. In the name of Jesus. Woo! Woo! Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, God. God said, don't sit down on the praise. Don't sit down on the praise. When the praises go up, I said, when the praises go up, the blessings, they come down. That's a promise. The blessings, they come down. Hallelujah. Woo! 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 Hallelujah! 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 Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, for making a way out of no way. Thank you, Lord, for saving my soul. Thank you, Lord, for choosing me. I didn't choose you. You chose me. My. That's why we celebrate him. That's why we lift up holy hands. There ought not to be a time when you can't stand up for the presence of the Lord. If you can't stand up, give him a wave offering. Give him something. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Give him the highest praise. Hallelujah. 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 Thank God. Thank God. Thank God. Call on his name. He's Jesus, the righteous, the bright and morning star, the lily of the valley, the good shepherd, the great shepherd, the eternal one, the almighty one, the blameless one, the provider, the almighty, the raising from dying. He is the creator. He's the restorer of the breacher. He heals my soul. You ought to praise your God. Praise him. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, that you come after me. Thank you, Lord, that you come after us. That your love is so immense. Your grace is so immense that in spite of me, you still come after me. Woo! We need to be mindful that we ought not get comfortable in our salvation. Stop thinking you ought to be here. None of us deserve to be here. It's only his grace that enabled us to be here. Woo! Feel like preaching now. Yes, Lord. In the name of Jesus. Because when I look back over my life and I think things over, I think what he brought me through, I think about how he made a way out of no way. If it had not been for him on my side, I would still be in the gutter. I would still doing all manner of things. But God, in all of who he is, and his holiness, his righteousness, his favor, yes, Lord, came and see about me, arrested my soul on that day. I thought I was just going to go give a small donation to a church, not knowing that my soul was going to be arrested that night. But God, in all of his sovereignty, who looked through the portals of time and said that you belong to me, sir, and I've got you right where you need to be. Hallelujah to the Lamb. Thank God for knowing that there's a need for reconciliation. Lord, never let me think of myself more highly than I ought to. Then he said, there's a way of reconciliation. And it's in the name of Jesus, who is the Christ, the perfect God-man. And then he said, not only is it the way, but there's a purpose. And that's why I get excited. Because in his sight, he said that he's going to be, Mr. Richardson, you're going to be blameless. You're going to be above reproach. Yes, Lord. My. He said, if you look at that text, he said, you're not only going to be all that, he said, you're going to be blameless and you're going to be holy and above reproach. When you think about what we have done in our life, the things we have done, they have not always been holy. They have not always been blameless. There are things that the accuser of the brethren brought before God, and it was true. Thanks be to God through our Savior Jesus Christ, who bore it at Calvary's cross, that there was an objection, and the judge said, sustained. Thank God,
He said, I'm going to raise you above the reproach. Above the reproach. No one can lay a charge at your feet because God said, I will not accept it. Mama, my. All we have to do is just think about where he is, who he is, knowing that he is the righteous one. And thank God that he stood in the gap for you and I, in the name of Jesus. That's why I don't mind coming and give him some praise. I don't mind letting that praise and worship go, because guess what? Some of us need that. We need it. We need it. Get back to some old worship. Worshiping him in spirit and in truth. Amen. But here's the thing. You can appreciate that there's a need for reconciliation, or there's a way, or that there's a purpose, unless you have come to know him. And if you don't know him, then there truly is a need in your life. And with that, I want to extend an invitation. I want to extend an invitation. This invitation, this first call, goes out to those who do not know the Lord. You have never trusted in the perfect work of Jesus Christ and his salvation that was worked at Calvary's cross. You've never fully trusted in that. I want to extend to you an invitation. The first call is for salvation. You don't know him, but you need to know him. You never fully trusted in the Savior. I want to encourage you to come. If that's you online, you need to call that number, 704-522-6480. Extension 12173. You need to call in that number. If you never trusted in the Savior, if you never trusted in the Lord, today is the day of salvation. As the saints of God are praying, someone is hanging in the balance. A soul is hanging in the balance. Someone could be in a different state that's watching us, and we are an extension of God's grace. That today is the day of salvation. If that's you under the sound of my voice, you need to know the Savior, but you have never trusted him, you need to come and meet us right here at this altar. If that's you, you need to come. You just need to acknowledge that I am a sinner. You need to believe that Jesus Christ bore my sin debt. Then you need to confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and that God raised him from the dead. He said, you shall be saved. It's just as simple as ABCs. You won't see the lightning flash or the thunder roar. You just need to come. And here's the thing. Don't think to yourself that, you know what, I'm still doing some things. I'm still holding on to this, or I'm still doing that. I want to wait till I get rid of that or let that go. Let me tell you something. You do not have the power or capability within yourself to do that. You need to come and let God let it go. If that's you, you need to.